The warehouse, are there no some kind of supplies for here?
Still, I don't know really. It's a government warehouse, I believe. About how large would you say this warehouse is? Wow. It's about 75 by 75 feet, about 25. 75 or 25 something. How many men were kept, how many prisoners were kept inside this warehouse when you were there?
Well, there were 4,000 men with me, then there were about a couple of more thousand Americans, might be more there, who were found me there when I arrived at the Lubau. Every, all the white men asleep in a warehouse, stay there, day and night.
What were the conditions inside this warehouse when you got in?
Very dirty, sir. Unsanitary.
Can you tell us, give us any reason why that was so? Might be so?
Because the men who stayed there before us, men had so much disease, dysentery, malaria, they can't go any place after they get to use it as a latrine more than anything else.
And the prisoners were forced to sleep inside that?
That's right, sir. You can't sleep no place else. The guards all run the warehouse.
How much space was there provided for each man inside this warehouse?
Myself, I don't think I had about 18 inches or no more. Might be less.
Could you lie down inside that warehouse to sleep?
No, sir. You have to lay one top of the other one and else. Sleep, they had a shelter all around the warehouse, a shelter. We sleep by the shelter, so every place else can sleep.
Now, what food was provided by the Japanese for the prisoners of war at Lubau while you were there?
The 17, we had little rice, not much really. And 18, we got some more rice, not much. Just enough to see we got something to eat, anyhow.
Were there facilities for securing the water by the prisoners?
We had one spectrum, we had to line up there, and the guards would die right down there. If you rush and knock you down with a club or a rifle, anything they got. It's taken time. Well, we used to get up at least about canteen of water daily, no more.
Now, did you see anything unusual happen at Luba while you were concentrated there?
Yes, we had the same trouble we had in Belanga. Nobody can cook any rice, because some of the Filipinos have still got uncooked rice with them. Two Filipinos taking chances, and they made them addict their grave and they buried them alive. Right in our life, right in the ground.
Did you personally see this?
Yes, sir. Everybody can see it. It's wide open, sir. Just like the air.
How far from where you were standing?
About 10 feet. 10 feet. I want to go back again, Orani.
All right, let's go back to Orani. Do you have something to tell
us
what happened there?
That's right. It was about 3 or 4 Filipinos that was buried alive also.
Tell us what happened there.
One of the Filipino raised their hands up, it was not quite dead, and pulled one of the Japanese guards right to the hole, to the graves.
Now, I don't believe the commission understands just what you saw there. You say you saw some Filipinos buried there?
3 of them, between 3 and 4
men. Were they alive when they were buried?
Yeah, they're all alive, every one of them.
In what were they buried?
In graves.
Right. And what did you see as these men were being buried alive?
Cooking rice.
What did you see with respect to these men who were thrown into these graves?
What do you mean, what happened?
What happened?
One of the Filipino got over one of the Japanese guards and put him down right in his own graves. Then the Japanese guard would get up. Now, come out of the grave, grab a hold of Bennett, drive with Bennett, like this, and they worked on top of the Filipino head, right through the head. Yeah, it was the last part of the Philippines, right there, dead.
And then they covered him up.
That's right, sir.
Well, what was the situation?
Well,
clean?
Dirty. Maggots. Worms.
Were the latrine facilities provided?
No, just a hole digged on the ground, a little ditch and nothing else.
Now what described this sanitary facility?
The
toilet there is no such thing, sir. All we had is just a little ditch. That's where we do our business, nothing else. It's very dirty. Maggots all over the place.
And who was concentrated here? What type of...
American and Filipinos. General Parker was in there for about quite a few days himself. General Parker.
Were the officers segregated from the enlisted men at any time during this march?
No, sir. With the exception of general officers.
Were the many men ill at San Fernando?
Quite a few, sir.
From what?
Mostly dysentery, malaria. Very, very.
Did the Japanese set up a dispensary there or medical aid station?
Nothing at all.
Did they provide any medical facilities?
No medical facilities and no doctors and nobody else around except ourselves, sir. Except the prisons.
Can you estimate how many men, prisoners, Filipino and American, passed through that area while you were there for the 8 days?
About 10 or 15 or 1,000 or probably more. Of course, I never counted them.
Now, what happened on the 26th of April, 1942?
The tell us to move out. We're going to Camp O'Donnell. Caps.
Where did they take you?
To Camp O'Donnell. They go on the train, of course, first. From train, they tell us over Camp O'Donnell. Lieutenant General Homma.
Are you sure that you saw the accused during your march from Bataan?
Yes, sir. Also, I saw General Homma marching through San Fernando.
When you were marching through San Fernando?
No, when we were San Fernando, stayed there for 8 days.
Where was he?
On a special car, on his own car.
Can you describe this car?
Well, describe a Japanese car. It was some kind of yellow streak in the ball front. I don't know what kind it was, really.
Questions by the court?
I think it was chief of case in chief, but I'd like
one more thing about this priest in Manila. Doherty, Archbishop of Doherty. He went, Archbishop of Doherty, the name. He went to the Japanese headquarters of San Fernando. 5, 6, 7 days straight. Asked permission to attend all the Americans. Prison war over to him.
You talk a little more slowly. I can't hear you quite well.
He went up to Japanese headquarters in San Fernando, at the Japanese headquarters in San Fernando. And he asked headquarters, the officer who's commanding off there, turn all the American troops over to Archbishop of Doherty. You know, the priest, high priest in Manila. And he will give you clothing, food, medicine. So when the war's over, all he wants are Japanese guards. To defend, nothing else.
Who told you that?
There's a woman, they call her White Cross, a Spanish woman. She came up to San Fernando there, right in our own yard. And I used to know this woman. This woman, she got killed. On the 13 days of February 1945, right across the way, from La Salle College. Yes, she was one
this day. Woman told you this at San Fernando?
That's right.
You didn't see Father Doherty there?
Now you say that you saw General Homer's car at San Fernando?
You passed by there.
Did you see the general in it?
Well, he was there, must be there. His car is there. Of course, I can verify the statement's correct, but it must be there, I believe.
Well,
I believe it must be in a car. It is, a car is there.
Well, you saw a car that had certain insignia on it.
And also, I asked the Japanese guard, I said, who's that man? He says, that's General Homma.
Did you recognize him?
Well, right there now, sir.
I beg your pardon?
I recognize him right now.
As being the same man?
That's right. He was a different man, a different dress, a uniform on it. It was the most start.
What time was that?
Between the 19 days, April 1942 to about the 26th.
Between the 19th of April and the 26th of April?
That's right.
Well, what date was it?
Well, I can't remember. I never had no diary keep down, you know what I mean? We were supposed to have even pencil with us, you know?
Well, you were at San Fernando, don't you?
That's right.
And you were there for those 8 days.
That's right.
When you saw General Homma's car pass, how long did it take to pass?
Pretty fast.
It passed?
Run at least about 25-30 kilometers on. Might be more.
I see. And did you see the car come into view, and did you see it disappear?
The way this was, I asked...